My name is Lisa Fauci, and I'm at Tulane University in New Orleans, Louisiana. One of the earliest memories that I have from being young, before 5 years old, was that my cousin, who lived in the same house as us, would give me math problems to solve. And I, you know, like 5 plus 2, he would write them on a piece of paper, and I would get them right. And it just was so affirming for me to have the attention of my cousin Damien, and it was fun. And so I always did well in math in grade school up through high school. That certainly changed when I went to graduate school, but it early on it came easy. I didn't realize early on that when I was in high school and so forth that there was a thing called a mathematician. I knew that I wanted to go to college and get a job afterwards. And so what was in my growing up was, if you're good in math, then you become an accountant, or possibly someone told me about being an actuary. But I did happen to come across my sixth grade album where your friend signed autographs before we moved on to junior high school. And it said, what do you want to be when you grow up? And I wrote a math teacher. So I'm living my dream. I'm living my sixth grade dream. So I'm an applied mathematician and a computational scientist. That's the label that I would agree to put down. So I work on trying to understand problems in biology, in particular biological fluid dynamics. So that's a mouthful, but in particular, the kind of projects that I am involved with, for instance, are to try to understand how organisms move around in a fluid at the microscopic level, like sperm cells or bacterial cells. And up to the macroscopic level of things like swimming fish. And so we use computer simulations to solve the equations of fluid mechanics to understand the whole all these complicated systems. So people might ask, you know, what fish swimming, of course, like basic science, is just interesting, but one project that I'm particularly excited about these days is joint work with biologists, in particular Jen Morgan at Woods Hole and Eric Titel at Tufts, and Christy Hamlet, who's also a mathematician, where we're trying to understand spinal cord injuries in you want to understand spinal cord injuries and recovery in humans, but particular types of fish are used as model organisms. So we're working with experiments where they study how fish swim after a spinal cord injury, and we're doing coordinated computer simulations. I told you earlier on that math came natural to me, and it was easy when I was a kid. And also through college at Pace, I did very well, although it was I studied hard. When I got to the Quran Institute, it certainly was a big shift. Pace, even though I had fabulous instructors, it was not a highly ranked mathematics department. And so when I got to Quran, it was I was with other students who had way more courses than I did and so forth. And I also was one of two women who are entering the class. And so it was a big ramp up. And so I did struggle the first year or two. And in fact, at the beginning of my second year, I did pass my qualifying exams, but the director of graduate studies did tell me that my pass was weak and that it was my last semester of support. And so I worked hard. I took his class, and in the end, he really supported me. But it was difficult, and there were some instructors that I had who made it clear that I didn't belong there. So in fact, the graduate coordinator, I'm happy to share this now, I'm not mentioning names. Because I was local, I interviewed at NYU before I was offered a fellowship or a teaching assistantship. And the head of the graduate program in my interview asked, what does your father think that his little girl wants to do something like this? And you know, that this is not the beginning of the 20th century. I know it's it's a few decades ago, but it still was a really jarring thing to be asked. So like at any institution, there are really supportive and fabulous faculty who want to lift up the students and help them succeed. And then there are others who, if you look like an other and you shouldn't be there, they're going to try to point that out to you. So thankfully, the first type of faculty at Courant were more than the second. Every day I am proud of what my students and my postdocs have accomplished. And I don't just mean in academics. I have students of mine have gone on to the pharmaceutical industry, cancer centers, data scientists at General Electric, that kind of thing. So you know that I work in applied math and numerical methods and computational science. And my first semester, I took numerical methods one with a wonderful professor, Mike Overton. But it was a lot. And I was studying for my qualifying exams, and I just I didn't take numerical methods too. I just said I can't do it. And of course, I then had to learn it on my own at some point when I knew what I was doing. But I guess the world comes full circle during Katrina. That Victor and I and the boys went to New York, and the folks at NYU were totally terrific. My advisor, Charlie Peskin, even before when our phones weren't working, he had this idea that we would probably be coming up there, and he arranged for NYU housing for us. It was all very wonderful. So we did end up, or I ended up spending the whole year there. Victor came back to Tulane, but I stayed there with the boys in school. And so they asked me at Courant if I would teach numerical methods too. So I wasn't ready to take it when I was struggling, but I taught it at Courant. It was a personal victory for me. Yes, I've had role models, mentors, and supporters. There's been a bunch of them, and I could look at different points in my career and see who was there helping me out or in the background. Even you could have somebody who's a role model that you see once every couple of years or so. A good friend of mine, Marsha Berger, who is in computer science, was a postdoc at Courant when I was a grad student. And she has helped me throughout my entire career, and we're still really good friends. But just to know, she was like my existence proof of a female mathematician who also, she had two sons. And, you know, now I'm dating myself. But now it's common for working female mathematicians to have children. If you go back 30 years ago, it was less common. And so even before that, you just wanted to know, oh yeah, She's a mathematician and a mother. You're not going to, whether you're a graduate student, an assistant professor, or a new software engineer somewhere, you're not going to uniformly receive praise for everything that you do. Especially in academics, we are always putting our work out there and getting criticism, right? Paper reviews and so forth, grant reviews. So it's great when you have something, a positive response. Oh, this is a landmark paper, or this is so beautifully written. But sometimes you'll get brutal criticism. From my first paper, the paper from my thesis. It was submitted to the Journal of Computational Physics. So I was a new assistant professor. I skipped over being a postdoc. And reviewer number three wrote, "This is not the sort of material that a high-class journal should be considering publishing. The analysis there's in biofluid dynamics here is useless. In summary, there is nothing of interest here, either computation-wise or physics-wise." Boom, reviewer number three. What do you think now, reviewer number three? But when you get a horrible paper review, a horrible grant review, if there's something constructive, listen to it and you know, don't block it out. But if someone's telling you that your work is awful, worthless, don't let it get you down. There's going to be awful haters out there.